and gentlemen, welcome to the second breakout session in the regional room. We are talking about ASEAN game changes. And today's panel of speakers, let me introduce them. Give a big round of applause to Lui Kin Ng from Glints, co-founder. Let's give him a big round of applause. Bobby Liu, Hub IT, the founder. Please give him a big round of applause. And Neelam Sari, owner and marketing director of Baba Rafi. Let's give her a big round of applause as well. Ladies and gentlemen, this session will be moderated by Dash from Startup Malaysia. Let's give him a big round of applause. Without further ado, I'll just let you take the floor.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for being here this morning. We have three panelists, from one from Vietnam, one from Singapore, and one from Indonesia. Huge markets. Asia is, you know, ASEAN is big market, 650 million people, and we're talking to what we call the ASEAN game changers. What do we mean by that? People who have actually redefined how business is done and who are actually using their home countries as a test market and expanding to other markets. And that's what's happening. At first, we had entrepreneurs who copied Silicon Valley and tried to do it in their own market and say they can't scale. But what's happening now in Asia is a new wave where they are using their home countries as test market and then slowly expanding. And let me pass the microphone to the lady first. And tell us, you have about 3 minutes. Tell us about what you do, Neelam Sari, and then we'll go to the next.
Hello. My name is Neelam, and actually we run for Baba Rafi. Probably all of you know about it. I mean, we opened already like 30 stores right now in Malaysia, but we run this business already like 13 years. I started at 19, and right now it's already like 30 years, yeah. And the total of the outlets right now, we have around 1,200 outlets all around Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, China. We have in EU one outlets, and also in Sri Lanka. And we will open soon in Singapore and also in Brunei Darussalam. Basically what we do, we open like a kebab, but the kebab is not something like a Middle East kebab. It's more to fusion food, something like Asian. So it's really adapt about Asian taste. And we're doing really good right now. And hopefully this year we will also open in Netherlands.
Hi everyone, I'm Chin Ng from Singapore. Yeah, I co-founded a company about a year and a half ago. It's called Glints. So what we do is we help young people discover and develop their careers. I think one of the main challenges that we find is, as young people, I think in the previous session they were speaking about, young people know what they don't want to do, but they don't really know what they want to do. So what we do is we help them figure out what they want to do, and we help them get there, to help them get their first job. Yeah, so that's what we do.
Yeah, I'm the youngest of the group. Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Bobby Liu. I own an incubator and accelerator in Hanoi, Vietnam. I'm actually from Singapore. But I've not lived in Singapore since 1988. Lived in five different other countries. So what do we do? In a nutshell, we also try to get everyone from Chinan's side, all the young people that don't know what they want to do, to try and promote entrepreneurship with them, to really be at the forefront of innovation, hopefully.
Thank you, Bobby. Maybe I will go back to Kin Ng, right? You said many young people don't know what they don't want to do. Do you want to tell us what are some of the things that they don't want to do?
Right, okay. So I think the stereotype for young people, unfortunately, is pretty true. Some of the things that they don't want to do. So, you know, on our platform, we have about 12,000 students from Singapore itself. About 40% are engineering students or people with engineering degrees. The unfortunate thing is that most of them, the most majority of them, actually don't want to do engineering careers. Yeah. The exception being software engineers and programmers. So those guys are the coders. Those guys are, charmed by Google and Facebook. So those guys love coding.
Right.
But when we talk about the engineering, things like, you know, chemical engineering, aerospace engineering, there is a surprisingly large number of people who graduate with those degrees, but the moment they graduate with those degrees, they want to move into something like marketing or business or management.
Why is that? Then why did they do it in the first place? Why did they spend 4 or 5 years of their parents' money doing this courses?
I think at the end of the day, it's the same reason. I think young people just, they don't really know what they want to do, right? So they'll just pick whatever that's on the table for them, or they'll pick whatever that their parents or their friends are doing for them. I mean, talking to a few of my friends, you'll be surprised at how many people make decisions on what to study in the university based on what their parents and their friends say, and not actually think about what they want to do, right? Which is concerning, and which is why we really wanted to grow our business to really help these people find their direction, hopefully before they graduate.
I see. Yeah. How do you do that? How do you get people to find their direction and find their passion, or what they call is find your element? You know, many people, even many young, many adults have not found their element. So they go to work every day, they're tired, they're in conflict with themselves. And tell me if this is true. Maybe Glint would work for people with midlife crisis. You know, we are some people are very, discontented with their work. And then they want to look for the weekend to release their tension. You know, how do you get people to find the direction, element?
Right. So I think it really starts it happens by a few layers, right? Mm-hmm. Usually we start off, you know, using the available tools and resources out there, you know, things like your personality test, your profiling test, but those only go so far, right? Yes. What we do next is we actually do industry and occupational profiling, and we get information, insider information, right? Not the kinds of things you find on like Google, on like the pay, the progression. We actually find out what is it like to be in the life of, say, an engineer, a life of in a startup, for example, right? And then what we do is we provide them the opportunities to try it out firsthand for themselves.
Right.
Sometimes it's in the form of internships, sometimes it's in the form of attachments, job shadowing. So essentially, it's a whole process that we put them through, right? And at the end of the day, what we want them to do is to just try, right? You have 4 years in university. Your goal is to try as much as you can, you know, try different experiences, figure out what fits for you, and then accumulate the right skills to get there.
I see.
Yeah.
So what basically Glint does is to put a mirror in front of a young person to reflect on and bring out the glint in the eye and say, boom, this is what I want to do.
That's right.
Am I correct in doing that? And I mean, I think then you'll have a great following around the whole world, actually, in that sense. Have you raised money?
Yes, we have. We raised last year. Okay. So the interesting thing about us, it's, I think I believe we are the youngest to might be the youngest to have raised in Southeast Asia region. Because the average age of the team is 22. So that's something something we're working on, because I think we understand the problem best. Right. They are our friends. We see them struggling.
Right.
And I think that's really what drives us every day to get up to work.
Right.
And also, like for us, the three founders, we actually stopped out of college to do this.
Wow.
And the logic being that I can spend half an hour doing an assignment, or I can spend a half an hour helping two of my friends get employed.
Right.
I choose helping my friends getting employed.
Oh, this is amazing because you are actually the testament to what a young person wouldn't want to do and what a young person want to do.
Yeah.
That you're sold into entrepreneurship, you're sold into building a venture, creating value, becoming a job creator. Now, I'd like to just quickly move to Nilam Sari. You know, and I met your, am I allowed to say this? I'm not sure. I met your husband about 10 years ago. He was such an enterprising young man who was selling kebabs, right?
Yes.
So have you, is that the business that you guys are in right now, or is it expanded to other products? Are you going into becoming a startup, which is, putting innovation into your product, you know?
Yes. So basically, we started 13 years ago.
Okay.
And we started with a pushcart at that time. You know, it's very simple pushcart, but at that time, we have a big dream, and we thought that, okay, it's not going to stop here. And we start to multiply the outlet, 1 becomes 6, 6 become 10, and then it's become 100, 200. Amazing. And then we have this kind of dream when we follow one of these, what do you call, franchise expo. Yeah. Okay, why don't we have one in Malaysia or something?
Right.
And then right now, alhamdulillah, we already opened in Malaysia,
Malaysia
and also other countries.
Yes.
And we start to follow after the GSY, actually.
Thank you.
Yeah, actually, I joined the GSY event.
GSY
here.
Is Global Startup Youth.
Yes.
It's a sorry for the plug-in. It's a Startup Malaysia program. Yes.
Apparently, yes.
It also transforms lives. Yes.
And I get the inspiration from there. And then we now start to open the Babarafi online. It's a platform to sell online for kebab frozen, something like that, at the first beginning. But and then right now we have some of the vendors, mm-hmm. which is small medium enterprises. Mm-hmm. They can sell their products over there. More about like a sambal, probably if you know something like a food, but it's mostly frozen.
Okay.
Also with sambal like chips or something.
Okay.
And we try to give them some platform if you want to. Because in Indonesia it's a bit different, yeah.
Right.
I mean, we already know about internet, but some of the small medium enterprises are still selling things through what you call direct selling. And we start to telling them, okay, you need to be online, you need to open your shops, and you can start here in Babarafi if you want to scalable your business, and you can start to do it here.
Yeah.
And also right now we just opened recently our we called Warung Mi, another brand of Babarafi. It's just opened like a week ago, and yeah, bismillah, we can probably multiply it. And also, we also have actually another brand we called Ayam Bakar Mas Mono. It's already open also in the Shah Alam, probably if you know, in Section 8.
8, okay.
Yes, so
are you going to use this opportunity to go and visit all your outlets in Kuala Lumpur?
Yeah? Yes, last night I met with my master franchise here in Malaysia, and we talk and yes.
And Handy, Nilam Sari's husband, was one of the in the apprentice, right?
Yes.
Yeah, in Apprentice Asia. And it was very insightful to watch what Handy was saying during the program. And I'll just quickly move on to Bobby, our wise man who runs an incubator, accelerator. Do you also have a fund, Bobby? And tell me about the entrepreneurial ecosystem in your country.
Well, my country is actually Singapore.
Singapore, okay, I got it.
But
okay, where do you live in?
No. You know, I tell all my friends in Vietnam that, you know, in my past life, if you believe in past life, I'm actually a Vietnamese. You know, somehow I got lost in the ether world, and then I got born in Singapore, and then now I've returned home, right? Okay, my whole life is all about entrepreneurship. I started my first business when I was 18. Like what Chin Nen said, okay, I knew what I wanted to do, I just didn't know what I did not know, right? Which are like 99% of any business, the difficulty of running businesses, right? I wish back then I had, people like Chin Nen, Nilam, or forerunners that will provide to me the motivation, the inspiration, and the know-how. Today, the young people are really lucky, right? They have JFDI, for example, that groom Glint. You have GSY, that groom other people, right? And for me, similarly, and this is what I feel is the need for me to do, to return to the young people. And to me, it's not so much, I just happen to be in Vietnam, because I like Vietnam. I could be anywhere. I mean, I could be in Mauritius, and I would still do the same thing. Because, ultimately, after all these years of doing business and all that, I just realized that in the end, the investment that you give to the young people is actually investment back to yourself.
Yes.
And developing an ecosystem, a community, is actually very important. And going back to the topic of what we're supposed to discuss today, to me, it's like coming full circle, and I realize that, to be a game changer is not about doing new things. To be a game changer is actually changing your own mindset and looking at outwardly to what you want to do. And that in itself will become the game changer for yourself and then for the people that, you interact with.
Yeah. Thank you, Bobby. You know, they say that the 4 billionth person going to be online is already happening anytime now. And if you are young, smart, and hungry, this is the time to embrace the entrepreneurial life. This is the time for you to say, okay, I can take the destiny of my life in my hands. I don't have to work for someone. I can just go and start a venture. Now, there is another school of thought. Many parents and thinkers in the entrepreneurship domain says that young people, after college, they should work for someone. I mean, I'm going to come back to the game-changing part. But before that, I wanted to get some basic understanding. Go and work for someone, get the experience, get the network. Because the first thing is, when you are starting a business as a college dropout or just graduate, one thing that you lack is what I call the credibility gap. Nobody knows you. The bankers don't know you. The funder don't know you. Not many people know you. You've got high, you know, the challenges are huge. How do you think, what do you think of that? Do you think that someone should work first or start a business first? Either of you can take this. And we'll open up later for questions. And right. Let's keep this fluid and, you know, jump in, you know, anybody want to jump in?
Yeah, sure. Okay, I'll
let's
start.
Break all the rules in ASEAN Game Changers.
Yes, okay,
in panel.
Sure. Yeah, okay, maybe I'll start first about what I think about the credibility issue and stuff. So we started a company 1.5 years ago. And actually, we almost went to jail for that because we actually started a company illegally while we were serving in the military. That's a separate story. If you want to find out the details, I'll tell you.
So you said you nearly went to jail?
Yeah, we nearly went to jail.
Really?
Yeah, we nearly went to jail. Because it's illegal to be serving the military and, you know.
I wish you went to jail because that would be a better story. That would be a greater story. Raise more money. Okay, go on.
Yeah. So, from Chinese prison. Yeah. Yeah, that would be the heck of a story to tell. Yeah. I think the thing is, I don't see education or even work experience as necessary to start a startup.
Okay.
I think most importantly is the attitude and mindset. I think as Bobby shared very accurately, you know, it's when you say game changing or like entrepreneurship, it starts with your mindset. Mm. And it's about being we like to call this relentlessly resourceful.
Right. Yes.
No matter the challenges that are ahead of you, you will just find ways and means to get past it. Right. When we needed the first seed capital for us to start it, we knew that if we don't get a seed capital, we were never going to take off. Right. So we didn't see that as an option. We just had to do it. Right.
Okay.
So I think it's something that it's more of attitude or mindset. I think, you know, the thing about education, the thing about work experiences, they're definitely helpful. You know, we realize as we go along the path, the more we do this, the more we realize we don't know. Right. But at the same time, I think it's more importantly the mindset, the attitude, to seek out people who know already and then tap on their brains, tap on their experiences instead of having to go through the whole process yourself.
But how do you create this kind of problem solvers? Please jump in, everyone. In schools, you know, I always believe that. I mean, I said this in a dialogue with our Prime Minister, that if you want to create high growth entrepreneurs, you need to create problem solvers in schools. And you also need to get a critical mass of people who can code. You are seem to be a natural problem solver, Nilam Sari as well. But how do we do that? And what is that a kind of a gene in someone? Or are the game changers evolving to be game changers, or are they born game changers? I have a view on that, but you know, before we talk about how you are changing the game in the venture, you got to be a game changer yourself, because that's what the discussion is. We're talking about the mindset, right? Bobby, you want to?
Okay. You know, you've got this whole thing about, you know, alpha personality, you know, B personality and all that. And I think it's inborn. Okay. Don't get me wrong. Every A personality will actually need a B personality to help them run the business, because the A personality will do the rah-rah show. Right, and the B personality will be behind you, keeping house.
Just hold that thought. You know, Peter Drucker said that in 1960. When you want to run a company, you got two types of people: one who build the track and one who drives the train. Okay, go on.
Yeah. Right, and you know, forget about startups for now. If you talk about, you know, real personality, for example, Yves Saint Laurent, right? You know, he was the one that's at cover of fashion magazine, newspapers, and everything else. Okay, but it's actually his partner that kept books, and planned the business, strategized the business to where it became. So for every business, and I'm sure you know Ching Ng and Neelam can share the same thing. Somebody is in the back of house that actually kept the house clean, and that allows you the freedom to be the rah-rah show that you're supposed to be for the A personality. So yes, I think partly is inborn. Problem solving is, you know, it comes to a point whereby, as what Ching Ng said, you see a problem and you don't start blaming. You don't say, oh, I can't do this. Oh my God, I got to raise money. This is so tough. I don't know this. I don't know that. You know, it's something that you just go like, okay, I got to do it. You know, there's no choice. You know, it's not an option. It's not like you wake up and you can decide A or B. No, it's not. There's only one way to go, and that's the way to go. It may be the wrong way, but even as you pursue down, the wrong way actually becomes the right way. You know, it's just a matter of, you know, being resolute and being relentlessly, what was it?
Resourceful.
Resourceful. Okay, quote that, okay? When he becomes famous, yeah, that's the quote. Relentlessly resourceful.
Yes, that's good, yeah.
Well, probably in my case is, when people thought that they want to open a business, they're always thinking about open something like restaurant. Yeah. Big number, big amount of money. Which is at the time, we choose to start something small with only $400 probably, 4 million rupiah equally. I mean, it's a little number. Do you know where I get that money come from? Mm-hmm. Actually, I get that money is from, you know, when you got married to someone and then someone will give you, you know, a pocket of money.
So you got it from all the angpao, they call
it. Yes, angpao.
Yes.
13 years ago, $400 is quite a big amount of money.
Can
and
you
we
imagine?
Started that. Yeah, that kind of numbers. And then we start with something really pushcart, food side stall. And then we just having, you know, like this belief that, okay, it can be growing bigger and bigger and bigger. And do you know something? Me or Handy, we don't have any education level at all. Because at that time, we married at 19. And, you know, we're just like
amazing.
Not, you know, finished our college. And at that time, we just... decide, okay, we have to start something business, but we don't have any money, so just start somewhere. And voila, here we are.
Very impressive.
You never know.
Ang Pao is the new Series A.
Yes.
<Angel. laughs> It's the angel, it's the seed. You know, that's, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, I have so many questions for that. You know, young people want to do, know what they don't want to do, and they know what they want to do. And now they have a formula to raise money as well. Get married, ask for Ang Pao. Okay, right. Bobby.
Oh,
you're just holding the mic. No, okay. So there was another question that I had, you know. If you look at Southeast Asia, Asia now, it's going there. It's a massive direction. Everyone, there's a lot of noise in startup. Every single country has got a critical mass of startup building up. The bubble is there. Do you think there would ever be a situation where, number one, that we would be, I'm not going to say this, but, you know, mirror Silicon Valley, but an Asian, is there going to be an Asian type where, in a small area, you're going to have the smartest and the most enterprising people. That's going to. Do you think that kind of phenomenon is going to happen anytime soon? And what's the role of governments in this? I know you're from Singapore. You're from Singapore, but you moved to Vietnam. Yeah. And how's Indonesia? What do you think about the role of governments? Okay, that's the first question. And then building the critical mass of young game changers, actually. Coming out from these ecosystems?
All right. There's never going to be another Silicon Valley,
okay.
Regardless of where. Okay. You know, but we can always look to Silicon Valley as a model. But we need to adapt. Mm-hmm. And this is where I believe, you know, growing up in Singapore helped because of the sensibility of our government. You know, basically getting the best of everything else,
right.
Discarding mm-hmm. what don't work. Mm-hmm. And then combining, you know, those elements. Mm-hmm. Silicon Valley, can we produce like, you know, big players in startup? In relative terms, yes. And there are already a few from Malaysia, you know, like my taxi or Grab Taxi.
That's right.
You know,
yes.
it's already a unicorn. You know, you have and then you've got okay, help me here. Who's the one that is just IPO? Anyway, you have like five startups
that went IPO.
Yes. All right, in Singapore, I don't think there's none at the moment. Yeah. Right, from a like startup type thing. Yeah. So yes, and then you know you look further afield. You look into China. You have like you know Alibaba, yes. Right, which is like. I got like a value at $150 billion, right? Yes. Yeah, it took them like 14, 15 years journey, you know, and I think you guys should Google Jack Ma. And he's really inspirational for, you know, at many different levels. You know, it's just the thought of, I need to do it. I need to make this a success. That I guess that was the only tagline that he had at that time to doing what he did, and until today, I think most entrepreneurs have that DNA strain, meaning to say, you just got to do it. There's really no choices. There's no fallback. There's no hammock below you that's gonna catch you. Silicon Valley is 100-year development. Okay, ASEAN is what 50 years. We will produce our own Silicon Valley, you know, and we will produce our own our own ecosystem. Okay, but very importantly, I feel, and especially doing what I'm doing in Vietnam, I really believe that ASEAN ecosystem, at least the top six nations in ASEAN, should really come together, work as a block, all right, and discover talents, discover and leverage off each other. Okay, learn the art of leverage. Leverage off each other what each of these top six nations are good at.
Right. They should cooperate and compete at the same time in getting to the Silicon Valley level. So how do you see Glint moving, becoming a game changer in the next 3 years? I won't say five because you never know. Let's talk about 3 years.
Right. I think before we get to that, I think about the role of how governments can really play a role in the whole ecosystem. I think, around the world, especially in ASEAN, governments are taking a much stronger focus on, startups. Yes. And that's why they have conferences like these. Yes. And the Singapore government, I think as you all would know, they pump in an incredible amount of money in the ecosystem. But I think, too much sometimes. Yeah.
Obviously, it's too much. And you also tell a good story, actually.
Yeah. But I think the thing that I think has to change in order for all these to really pay off and in order for us to reach, like, the Asian Silicon Valley, it's for the startup entrepreneurship mindset and this advocacy to be spread to spread throughout the entire government and, most importantly, to our education system.
Yeah.
I see it personally as a challenge that on one hand, my government is spending in a lot of money to pump into like startups.
Yes.
On the other hand, our education system is the same way it was.
Right.
It's still producing people who are top students in exams.
Right.
Right? But we are trained not to be risk takers. We are trained to be the top lawyers, the top doctors, the top engineers. Well, we need these people, right?
Yes.
But until we can adopt this mindset across every single aspect of the government, especially education, I think, there will be a lot of challenges. So I think in order for us to really get to be an Asian Silicon Valley, whether it's Singapore, whether it's Malaysia, whether it's any country, I think most importantly, the education must adapt and transform to reflect this kind of new approach.
Right.
Yeah.
Neelam, sorry, you have anything to add to that?
Yes, in Indonesia right now, the happening is there, actually. I saw a lot of my friends, which is now open something like Grab Taxi, but it's Gojek. Do you know Gojek?
Gojek
is with motorbike. They can take you somewhere or taking your food or deliver something. It's like another level.
Yes.
And the government actually right now is start to, giving support and a lot of seminars or something like that. But I think it's still far, Indonesia, to develop this thing to another level. And definitely it's, we need all the collaboration between the government and the entrepreneur and also the mentors.
Yes.
Because in Indonesia right now, the government sometimes, walking by their own way, and also the private, us as a entrepreneur giving some, seminars or teaching them like, okay, when you start your business, you have to do this, this, and this. But it's not like what do you call? It's going separately. You know, it cannot be collaborated or something. So we have to talk, sit down, and
talk
make it happen. Yes.
Yeah, I think there is a big tectonic plate. It's a movement, right? You know, when Malaysia had its first entrepreneurship ministry, it was run by bureaucrats. It was run by government people. We call the Ministry of Entrepreneurship. And then it was dissolved subsequently. And then, I don't know, it got dissolved because I remember that I met the Minister of Entrepreneurship at one meeting, and we were talking, and I told him a story. I said, you know, about 15 years ago, I met a minister of IT from India, and I asked him a question. When did technology or IT become a big thing in India? And he said, when there was no IT ministry. So, you know what I mean? So this minister went around saying to everyone that, oh, the same joke over and over and over. But anyway, the IT ministry got dissolved. But now, today in Malaysia, we have magic. We have many people, you know, and magic is being run by entrepreneurs and young people. So I think we have shifted quite a lot. And it appears that the government is listening to the young people. There's a lot more dialogue that's happening, and the government is hosting many of this. So I think we are moving in an amazingly right direction for us to create more game changers. And that's quite a positive thing. Shall we open it up to the... to the floor for some questions before we keep talking here.
Gentlemen, if you have any questions, mics over there.
Anyone have any questions? While we wait for your questions, you know, I have a question. You know, they say that you know, when you want to start a billion-dollar company or a big company, right? You got to start small, and the mindset of someone wanting to start a billion-dollar company and someone wanting to start a million-dollar company is different, right? So this is where I think the real game changers come. To be able to start something small but have a big dream and not start something big and fail big. Like how you have started, and you have started from your ang pao and what you are teaching.
Begging,
is it?
Yeah. Lots of begging.
You want to add to that? You know, how do you get the mindset change in your Vietnam and get more people to do those kind of stuff?
Okay, I agree. You got to start off something with really huge vision, see as far as you can possibly see, and then see a bit further, and the ability to see far is through mentors that you have, the advisors, you know, and today they are readily available. You have Magic, you have JFDI, you have, I think Telkomsat has a huge accelerator, you know, and pretty much that's what I'm doing as well in Vietnam to inspire the young people. Because a lot of young people, they don't know what they don't know. Okay, we are there, we are here to basically provide them, you know, to look from their vision, from that point of view, okay, how far that idea can carry. Now, obviously, you start small, you know, Glenn, just in Singapore, and then, you know, we talked briefly earlier, you know, what's his ambition in scaling to outside of Singapore. You know, you got to look at that, because if you don't, okay, then you fall way short than where you're going to be. If you look to like $1 billion, okay, you probably may not reach $1 billion, but you probably get to at least $500 million. That's better than $1 million, you know. So you got to look big, because when you look big, all of a sudden, you know, your bird's eye view, you know, become totally different. You see a lot more things. You see a lot more holes that you need to plug. And that's when you know who are the people you need to bring in to plug those holes, so that you're able to create the runway, the pathway to where you want to be.
Thank you, Bobby. I think we have about 5 minutes, and I want to go back to you, Chinese. How would you, you know, you want to say something about how you envision your company going forward, being the game changer, and you want to, how big, you know, what's your dream, you know, and what's your advice to young entrepreneurs who are in the room, or also to educators and to parents when they want their kids to, you know, I have children as well, and they are always playing games, building games, coding, and breaking into the security systems of your school, you know. So, you know, so go ahead, you know, tell us
right.
about.
Okay, so I think, so for us, our vision is really for any young person, give us any young person with the right attitude and we'll get him his dream job. So that's our vision, right? Essentially, you give me the right person, you don't need to have any skills, you don't need to have any experiences, but you give me someone with the right mindset, with the right mentality, we will get him
but
to his dream job.
But if the person is the right mindset, they would yes. find it anyway. So can't we give you someone who doesn't have the right mindset? Is that able, were you able to do something? Is Clint able to do something with that?
So I think that's something that, we, you know, we are always trying different ways and means to outreach okay. and engage where they are. But I think a lot of times, I think young people, the reason why they don't have the right mindset is to start off with, they are lost. Mm-hmm. So as a result, they feel discouraged and therefore giving the impression that they don't really, you know, have the right mindset, they're not motivated. But I think what is really important is about finding out, you know, what they want, what their needs are, you know, taking the time to get to know them. And I think once that is, it's very easy to get into the right mindset.
Right.
Yeah.
How do you make money?
How do we make money? Yeah, we actually do not charge young okay. people because, okay. I mean, that's young people who don't really have a lot of money.
Yeah.
Right. So, but we primarily charge the employers. Right.
Ah, okay.
So employers, one of the challenges they face is also finding the right talent. And most of our employers are actually small to medium companies.
Right.
Now, the big companies like, you know, Google, Facebook, Procter & Gamble, they don't have issues hiring the top talent, right? They don't have issues hiring the right talent. But these small and medium companies, right, companies that people don't usually think of when you look for a job, right? These are the ones that they need talent even more so to grow the company, to make it successful. So we actually help these employers find the right talent faster.
Right.
Yeah. On average, it takes about 1.5 months to fill a job. Right, but we cut the time down by half to about 2 or 3 weeks.
I see.
And it's this value proposition that's our primary business model.
I see.
Yeah.
But what if these young people don't find the companies that you are matching them with as sexy, or they want to go to Google or Facebook or, you know, so how do you deal with that?
Because
okay, this is my right job, but I don't want to work for Lim Tire or something like
exactly.
that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So in fact, that is the exact reason why companies work with us. We make their company sexy to work for.
Okay.
Exactly. Yeah, because we know what young people are looking out for. We can take any company, like literally, and that is what we have been doing. We make any company sexy to the young person. Okay. And it's not about cheating them or selling fluff.
Okay.
It's really about just bring out the learning opportunities.
Okay.
If you think about, I mean, for you guys who have hired before, if you think about how you write your job descriptions, you write, I want this. It's like a bucket list that you want as an employer.
Yeah.
But what we do is we take that list, we turn it around into what this means for the young person. What kind of learning opportunities will you get? What kind of growth opportunities you have? So it's that kind of spin that we add to the whole process.
Actually, it's funny. Startup Malaysia, we hire people as well, and a lot of people, and we don't give them a job description. We don't. There is no list. I think it's any Startup Malaysia team here. And we just say, come in and just do it.
Exactly.
You know? So that's how it is. I think the culture is changing, and that's what we do. What's your advice to the young people and how to become game changers and, you know, and
just follow
any
your
general
dreams.
Anything?
Just follow your dreams and start actions, because the only thing that we have is only time, right?
Yeah.
And even though me, I'm not even, you know, finish my or graduate my college, is I can do it.
Wow.
With only Ang Pao, right? Series A investment. we can do it. And a lot of people saying that, Nilam, you're not going to make it anyway because it's only push card. It's not going to be less or... What are you doing with your life? I mean, you're a graduate from... I mean, you're now school in one of the best university in Surabaya. I mean, it's like the second biggest city in Indonesia. And what are you doing with your life? I mean, why you mess with your life and you selling something like pushcart? But yeah, we have dream over there. And not ever let anyone told you that you cannot do it. Just do it. And we also have actually a class to a startup. We give them something technique and basic, something like, how do you set the cost? How do you set the franchise agreement? How do you set the SOP and everything? Because right now in Indonesia, the government, like I said, the government and also the private sector is not really, what do you call, collaborate together to help the startup and entrepreneur. So we give them something like a class. It's like a, what do you call, basic class, a week, basically 5 days a week. And we give them something that really technical and basic.
Okay.
And it's not just motivation, but mm-hmm. they can also learn directly, see Baba Rafi can do it, and you can always do
right.
it.
Right.
Yes.
But just back. Go ahead.
Curious. Okay, before I came to this panel here, I imagine, you know, we're going to have a lot of young people.
Yeah.
Actually, we got a lot of orang tua.
Oh my God, that's no such thing.
Okay, in the 30s, 40s even, yeah, I think. Yeah. All right, so I'm just curious. Why are you guys here? Are you guys like having sort of, you know, whatever, a second thought about wanting to do something on your own, wanting to hear from people, you know? So anything from the floor?
Anybody, any questions from the floor? From the, yeah.
Here is a question.
And there's two questions, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Both are young.
Okay.
Go for it.
Hi, it's Ibrahim here.
Ibrahim, hi.
Hi. So yeah, I can see some young entrepreneurs here. So basically my question to them, and you can also share some ideas, some views here. So my question, like, well, you're sharing like some engineers, like personally I'm an engineer here. I'm now studying like mechanical engineering, third year. So some engineer, like you said, like even like they're doing engineering, not to deal something in entrepreneur or something, completely different field, but they just want to get it done ASAP. And after that, they want to enter like his entrepreneurship, try to make their own sign or their own trademark, something like that, right? So what, how, like after they're done with the, maybe they're, now they're like having their education, like they need to finish their studies first. So like for me, I'm just putting myself in the shoes of an engineer, someone like in my age, right? So like how they can prioritize, like how they can like choose the goal, like how to prioritize between the things, like whether it's like the heart's call, like should they listen to it, and how they'll get to know like where they really can succeed, right? So that was my first question, like whether maybe just go like the normal way, like the way it's like the traditional way, right? Or thinking out of the box, doing something bit different, right? So how they can choose that option, or how they can motivate themselves to choose that option, right? So that's the first question. Second question is like to be motivated all the time is not a easy thing. You have the motivation, and after sometimes you lose it, right? It's like you lose it, right? So it's like motivated, being motivated for like 1 week, you're so motivated, or 1 month, you're so motivated. And after that, like you're losing. And then you're saying like, what to do? I mean, why I'm here? I could have done like the way my friends getting a job. They're like hired good companies. They're having at least some salary. And I'm losing everything. So what I'm doing here, just get back to my old place where I truly belong, or something like that, right? You get me, right? So how then you can keep yourself motivated to push your goals, to push your dreams? So that's the second question.
Thank you.
So I think you got this.
Okay, I'll start. Okay, I studied mechanical engineering too.
Yeah.
And somewhere down the line, I actually had a fashion company. How did that connect? Okay. Yeah. Okay. So in mechanical engineering, I majored in industrial design. So maybe innately, I'm sort of creative in that sense, right? And using lessons that I learned in school. It's not about mechanical engineering. It's about the lessons you learned in school. It's about the principles. You know, what guide you. For me, when I do my design, it's about practicality. You know, you can have the best design, but if it's not practical, it's not going to work. So that drives, you know, my creativity, practicality, you know. Motivation, that part I cannot help you. Because as what you say, oh, my friends are doing this, why can't I do this? You're having second mind, you know, second thought to what you want to do.
I can help with that later.
Yeah, okay, so whip him up. But
no motivator.
That's something that, you know, we cannot help because it has to come from yourself. Yeah. There is never ever going to be a time when you wake up and say that, man, I should have joined Google. No. It'd be like, you know, every morning you have to wake up and say that, I'm going to beat Google. And that's what Google did when they first started. You know, that every day they woke up and say to themselves, okay, we're going to beat the shit out of Yahoo. And they did. You know, that's the single-minded attitude that you have to have. And it comes down to a really small band of people.
Yeah.
Either you're, you know, stubbornly stupid or you're stupidly stubborn.
Yeah.
Probably from me is there's no, you know, like regular way. You have to find the amazing way that will be, you know, fit you. And you can do whatever you want. As long as you're serious and keep doing it, I mean, not stop, you will find your way. And how to motivate yourself? For me, it's always work when I'm, you know, finding my friends like this, the crazy people like this. And it always give me, you know, like a positive aura or something.
Feedback.
And when I have problem, they will I can share to them, and then they will give me some, you know, like advice or things. But there's no choice to go back. Nilam, you have to go faster, something like that. And there's no choice to, you know, like, oh, why I doing this business or why I'm not going to Google or something. But the only thing choice that you have is you have to move forward and not stop and do whatever it takes to make it bigger and bigger. Because big is not an option. You have to be big.
So bottom line, having crazy friends, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I think the points that they raised up are very relevant. But I think it's very important for me to emphasize one part, and it's something I see a lot of my friends do. Honestly, me and my co-founders, we are not the smartest people around, by far, by a lot, right? But I think the thing about it, it's a lot of times young people and my friends, we have a lot of ideas, but very few actually get about to doing it, right? I think ideas, it's the cheap part, right? Like if you want ideas, you can go Google and there's like 1,000 business ideas that you can do. But I think execution is what it's the really difficult part, and it's something that you just gotta, you know, wake up every day, tell yourself you gotta do it, right? For us, you know, it's about removing your second options, right? Just to share, me and my two other co-founders, we actually went to college last year for a very short period of time in the United States, right? It was great. It was a lot of fun. We just wanted to know what college was like. But then we realized that it wasn't the right thing to do for the business, right? We were creating backup options for ourselves, right? So what if our startup doesn't work out? Oh, we just go back to college.
Can you tell them what colleges you guys went to?
Oh, okay. So two of my partners, one of them was at Wharton at UPenn, and the other one's at Berkeley, and then I was at Stanford. Yeah. So, yeah, these aren't bad colleges to, like, these aren't bad backup options at all, right? But for us, what it meant was that in order for us to make our startup succeed, we had to remove that option. And that's the reason why I'm here and not over there, right? The weather there is much better, but I'm here, yeah. So I would say, if you feel that's something you really want to do, remove all the back paths and just only have that one way forward going, yeah.
Thank you.
That's amazing. Give him a round of applause. Not so smart, but went to Stanford and quit Stanford. You know, this is amazing, right? So talking about motivation, if I may just add, Razif, and end it, you know. You know, you could very easily be demotivated in the entrepreneurship field, right? And is that me or what? It could be very easily demotivated. You know, they say that 8 out of 10 businesses fail in the first year of your starting a venture. But if you keep thinking about these kind of statistics, you'll never do anything. The way to keep motivated is first you must find your passion. This is what I really want to do. And the second thing is to keep doing things. You know, your bias for action. Every time you do something, you fail smaller and smaller, and it increases the probability of your success. You know, to me, that's the only way to keep motivated, because success matters. Failure is inconsequential, you know, so you got to keep doing it. And with that, you know, to all the three ASEAN game changers, you know, I would like to thank you for coming to Malaysia, sharing your thoughts, you know, and please catch a hold of them and ask them for more ideas. Thank you very much, Bobby, Neelam, Sari.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Once again, a big round of applause for Lui Kin Ern, Bobby Liu, Neelam Sari, and of course, the very witty Dash from Startup Malaysia. We are breaking for lunch right now, and we will resume our session at 2 p.m. Next up in this room, I'm not so sure what, because I'll be in the other room, but we're having a very interesting lunch session, so I hope to see you all there. Thank you very much.